Greetings, Cleveland, and welcome to Creative Focus, the show that illuminates some of Cleveland's most talented and creative artists across the genres of film, dance, music, theater, and visual arts. I'm your host, Cornell Calhoun III, and I'm excited to have as my guest on Creative Focus today, Cleveland's own award-winning filmmaker and photographer, Mr. Robert C. Banks. Robert, welcome to Creative Focus, man. Let's chop it up, man.
Wow, I was like, okay, yeah, how you doing?
You like that intro?
That was nice. I wasn't expecting that. It's like, you know.
No problem. Hey, so Robert and I are neighbors. We live at the Tower Press development on Superior Avenue, Artist Building, great landlords, Dave and Karen Prokowski, great maintenance guy. I gave a shout out to CJ. He's doing a fabulous job. Mm-hmm. Robert, how long have you lived in the Artist Building?
Well, it's more like I work there. It's more like a workspace than live there. I've been working out of there, it'll be 20 years.
20 years?
Yeah. Okay. It'll be 20 years this June.
20 years this June.
Yeah, and it feels like yesterday too, because I'm between there and my mom's place, and I needed another workspace to do what I need to do. Because before I was there, I was working at, believe it or not, there's a whole weird story to this. I had a setup in my mom's attic, and it was a little studio setup that I made up. You know, lighting, very similar to this. I had seamless backdrops, mics, everything to do production in my mom's attic. And the post-production was done in the basement. I had like a small editing setup and lab in the basement. And that was cool for like a good 7 years, 7-8 years. And I cranked out a lot of stuff, but it was just not, I just needed more space. I needed more formal, you know, atmosphere. And so when I heard about the Tower Press being renovated, because I'd been past that building a billion times when it was a derelict, and I always thought, man, this would be a cool place to work. In fact, that whole area and that district is just great. I heard, hey, they're going to be looking for artists to be working out of here. And I'm just thinking, So I signed up. A month or so later, they were doing the interviews, and I managed to get involved with a few other artists, and we managed to get, you know, we all lucked out, and we were the first. And that space has been like a second home to me, literally. And it's been forever.
Yeah, it's been forever.
I mean, it feels like yesterday, because like I said, I mean, it's when I first started setting up and working in there, it was just one big empty room with a little bit of gear here and there, and now it's like this almost storage space facility, because all my equipment is there, costumes, props, wardrobe, cameras, lenses, editing stuff. So yeah, it's been a second home for me.
So and, you are one of the most respected filmmakers. You are.
I know.
You're iconic. I had Johnny Wu mm-hmm. on recently, mm-hmm. and he talked about how you helped him. What was the inspiration that got you into film?
That's another interesting story. I guess you can say this was one of those classic stories of family in the inner city, in the Huff area. Yes, we're, you know, born and raised in the Huff area.
Right.
My dad met my mom. She already had 4 kids already, and she had finished 2 previous marriages. Met my dad, who was pretty much working for the city, actually. He had a rough time at first. He was sort of working on the other side of the system, got in a lot of trouble, cleaned up his act, paid his debt to society, and he decided he wanted to settle down, but he was going to make right. And my dad went out of his way and took care of my mom and her kids, and I came next, and I was his only child, and he was extremely overprotective of me. And my mom thought that the arts was a good thing to keep us out of trouble. We were all raised in music, because my mom played music, my brothers and sisters, they all did music, half brothers and sisters, all, you know, and I was introduced to music also. My uncle was actually a jazz drummer.
Mm.
And I loved music also. I really loved music. However, I also loved visuals and I loved movies as a kid. And without getting too detailed on all the crazy stuff, my dad had film equipment for a lot of his friends. And my dad was an older gentleman. He was much older. He was 11 years older than my mom. So his friends were pretty much old school. Now this is like in the mid late 60s.
Right.
And so, you know, back in the day, they used to have those crazy parties, those little stag parties and stuff like that. People might know what that is.
Right.
My dad had equipment primarily for that, but he kept that away from me. So there was stuff going on, but I was more intrigued by the equipment, the projectors and the, you know, all that stuff. So So my dad was like, well, you like that stuff? Well, here, let's do this. And so there was a time when you can go to the department store and you can buy condensed versions of movies on 8mm film reels.
Right.
And so my dad would buy all these classic B movies that were like condensed digest versions, animated cartoons. So it was like Deputy Dog, Mighty Mouse, Woody Woodpecker, stuff like that. And the movies were like a lot of B horror films, The Amazing Colossal Man, Earth versus the Spider. If people know B movies, we're going to talk about that in a minute. But basically, he allowed me to play with the projector and run these for myself, and I would run these for my friends. Now, I was 6 years old. I was only a little kid. And the magic of that process sucked me in tremendously. And between that and watching movies on TV, like the old Hulan and Big Chuck or The Ghoul or Superhost, all those shows. Watching all those movies. And then at some point when I was old enough, I actually got to go to the theater, and they would take us to see the Disney movies on the big screen. All that pretty much, I just knew this was something that was great. And at the same time, and like most kids, you're always indulging in fantasies and all that, because the neighborhood wasn't rough as we know it now, but it was still rough enough. And so I was always getting into these fantasies, and all my friends I grew up with were always fantasizing all this stuff. So my thing was, there was a way you could bring that stuff to life by creating it and designing it on your own and everything. And my dad and my mom taught me how to take the bare essentials. Because, you know, you're always led to believe that doing movies is a big, grandiose, expensive thing. It's like, well, you can take that piece of paper there and this cardboard here and these cups here and all these little odds and ends, and you can make things and all that. And so this whole process within 10 years took me to where I wanted to be for the rest of my life. I knew this is what I wanted to do more than anything else. And it's just this classic little story about that. And I've been doing it ever since. My dad gave me a camera afterwards, and I learned how to operate that. It was an 8mm Bell & Howell. That got damaged. He took it on a trip and he busted it accidentally. And that was the regular 8 format. The new format was Super 8 at that time. And he bought us a Canon M12 Super 8 camera, basic camera, and a JAF projector. And that was it. And that was my gear. And I started doing little stop motion animation stuff. I was doing all kinds of weird pop in, pop out effects. Just doing a lot of weird, crazy stuff, experimenting. And the next thing was the audio. He was giving me these old tape recorders that he would get from the Goodwill. And I was recording sounds all over the place, you know, found sounds or making up my own sounds or recording stuff off the TV, basically looping and sampling. I was doing that kind of stuff, not knowing what I was doing. And I would run those audio tracks or audio, what do you want to call them, sound bites with the films I was putting together. And that was pretty much, that was like, that wound up being in the late 70s. And then going into the 80s, I knew I want to make movies for the rest of my life. And that in a nutshell, that answers the question, because that's pretty much what it's all about. I mean, it was just a matter of understanding the logistics as well as the human aspect of it, because people make films, not equipment. And so it took me a few years to understand that you can't really rely on the technology. It's all about what's in your mind and your heart and your emotions and all that stuff. So
I got a photo of you about when you were about 10 or 11. I want to show the audience. Robert was in his filmmaking early on. Take a look at that photo. But a quick question in terms of filmmaking, you know, a lot of times people think you have to go to New York or you have to go to LA to make films, to be a successful filmmaker. I don't know, maybe perhaps that's true, but what benefits do you see for you staying in Cleveland?
Okay, see, that's funny you mention that, because that's a real tricky question, and kind of it's a weird debate too, because I disputed that for a while, and now I've sort of accepted certain aspects of it, because you have to look at it from different perspectives. When you think of Cleveland, you think of what? You think of sports, you think of education, you think of the clinics and the hospitals.
Think of the arts and theater.
Yeah, but the arts and the theater are always in the back burner, because sports, industry, salt, coal, steel, blue collar, that's Cleveland. The arts was always the recreational entertainment. It was never seen as an industry. That's the industry. But you go to LA and New York, entertainment is in the forefront. That's the billion-dollar industry, and they treat that like it's the end-all, be-all. We don't do that here. We were always about, you know, everything as far as manufacturing and utilizing the resources and educating people. People come here because the cost of living is good. They want to raise their families here, and all, which is great. But the arts, like the way my parents raised us, they just wanted us to basically create, to stay out of trouble, to be in the right state of mind and growing up and learning things in terms of who we are, but still have fun. It was not meant to be a career. It's not meant to be anything that's going to really take you on a more formal level of living a good life and buying a house and having a family. It wasn't, they never equated that with that. That was strictly, you do that on the side for fun. And I think the consensus is that to succeed in the filmmaking, for instance, or if it's gonna be dance or music or entertainment, anything like that, you have to be in the proper market. When you think of the city of Cleveland as an art mecca, a lot of people tend to sort of think, well, that's nice that you're doing that, but that really, you, nobody's interested in that because that's not gonna take you anywhere where you need to be in terms of a career. But the people that do succeed, they leave Cleveland. When you think of some, there's like many actors and directors and filmmakers or whatever that came out of here that moved to LA and New York and they became huge. So the talent is here. It's just the resources for people to make a living here and to really stride and towards that in terms of succeeding, it doesn't really equate here, at least not yet. I think Cleveland has been working towards that, but I don't wanna say it's 10, 20 years too late, but I just think that it took longer for things to really take off for people like myself and like Johnny Wu and the many other talented people. There's a huge talent pool of people here that are phenomenal. And if you were to, if Johnny Wu, for instance, was to go to LA and someone gave him $100 million to make an epic martial arts sci-fi movie, he could do it. It's within him to do it, you know? Mm-hmm. Case in point, look at the Russo brothers. You know, they went to LA and they paid their dues and they were at the right place at the right time. And, you know, case in point, you have all these big Marvel movies they're doing. So, I mean, I'm not saying it can't be done here, but I think the community here has to really embrace the talent that they have and the skill set that's here, because we have the tech. We have plenty of guys and gals here that know their stuff. They know how to set up lighting. They know how to rig up dolly. They know how to work cameras. We have phenomenal stunt people here. We have a lot of things, designers, makeup artists, production coordinator. It's all here, you know, but the infrastructure isn't here for this to really hold itself up in terms of an industry, because it's not about that. It's about the other things, you know. We love our sports, you know. If we embraced filmmaking the way they embrace sports here, or they embraced other you know, blue collar type stuff, because I consider film production blue collar. It's very blue collar. At the same time, it's also a fine arts component in terms of making things and all that, and the things work hand in hand. But you go to New York and LA and it's like, it's a no brainer. You eat, breathe and sleep that. But here it's sort of like a weird dichotomy. So
what was your first film? You remember your first film, the first film?
The very first film I ever made, yeah, or the first film that actually opened up doors?
Give me both.
Okay, well, the first film I ever made, that's dating back to the late 1970, I wanna say 76, maybe, you know. I played around with the camera before that, but as far as me actually making films, in other words, my dad would get me a roll of film and I would make something. That was like in the mid-late 70s, so maybe 75, 76. Okay. And some of those films didn't even turn out. After that, I started doing some of the stop motion stuff. And these were like little 10, 15, 20 second little things I would put together. So I didn't really have any names. They were just little experiments I was doing. And which is hence why I was labeled as experimental filmmaker, because a lot of what I was doing was experimenting with the process, a technique, a little story method, whatever. So those were like late 70s, early 80s. I was scratching on film like in 79, 80. We had the Cleveland teacher strike, remember that?
Right.
That was a good time for me to stay home and play around with stuff. And I was making a lot of crazy films then. And that was when I started exploring scratching on film, which I'm known for doing with the Malcolm X film you saw. Now, as far as my first film that opened up the door unofficially, That would be my film I collaborated with Dexter Davis and some friends of mine. That was the first film I made after I was discharged from the Air Force. I was in the military. I was discharged, and I knew at that point, because this was after my father sadly had passed away, and since he sort of gave me this whole idea of being an artist with this, I figured, okay, I'm going to pursue this. This is going to be in response to my dad's legacy. So I got my buddy Dexter Davis, who we were CIA students at the time at the Institute of Art. When I got out the military, I said, hey man, let's get together and do something. And so I had a Bolex camera that a friend of ours from the Institute of Art sold me for next to nothing, like $48. And we did a short film. And I used Dexter as the center hub with all these other artist friends of ours. Some did music and dance, some were smoking a cigarette, just goofy, weird, old school, black and white, 16 millimeter underground filmmaking. And that film played at a few clubs in Cleveland. And that was when I started getting a little name recognition, say, hey, Robert Banks made that. Look at that crazy stuff he was doing. And that film was an experiment. The film that opened up the door on a more master scale came a few years after that. Because I did a few shorts after that film with Dexter, and then this film I did based on not so much Malcolm, Spike Lee's Malcolm X, not to mention that name, but right. I'm not knocking Spike Lee because right. people assume that. But this film was about basically commercialization and marketing of basically somebody that's important, someone iconic like Malcolm X. And that's when I did the, it's called X the Baby Cinema. And that was the film that literally everything I'd learned up until this point with playing with film and painting on the film, this film was that. It was cut out animation, flip books, scratching on the film, layered compositing, all done in camera with the same 16 millimeter Bolex. That was the film that opened up the door. That film took off.
And what's the title again?
X the Baby Cinema.
X the Baby Cinema.
Yeah, and baby cinema meaning it was just a little small film. The film was only 4.5 minutes and it was very basic, very entry level. My friend Elmer, Elmer Turner, he did the soundtrack on his little 4-track mixer. Then my friend Vito and his girlfriend at the time, they performed the music instrumentally for me. And the film just opened up all these doors. And I had, you know, it was something that I was sticking by because I was just saying, you know, why is it that we have to take something like historical and just make it a mark, a fashion trend, whatever. And it wasn't just that, but it was just everything and anything about within the community, how we're never legit in maintaining something that is truly ours and sharing it, but also holding it up in as value, you know. And instead, and you remember, you know, when the Malcolm X, when the movie was coming out, it was all hype and promo and everybody had the hats and the jerseys and the, and you know, and I just knew this is not gonna last because everybody on the face of the earth at that point was wearing the stuff and nobody knew what it meant. And I just thought that kind of sucked.
Okay. Well, let's take a look at a clip from X, the Baby Cinema by Robert Banks. About that film. Give me one thing that you remember most about that film.
Making that film for me was, for lack of a better word, it was definitely enlightening because I made something that was with my own two hands and I had a few friends of mine assist me. My one buddy, Larry, did some of the flipbook animation and my other friend, Derek, did the jumping jack animation. And I did everything else. I was basically literally collaging stuff. It's a collage piece.
Okay.
It's a good example. Some people would say it's an experimental film. I consider it more of a straight commentary using experimental techniques. And that film took me 8.5 months to make. And it was literally, it went through several stages. And when it was finished, the end result is what you saw right there. And I screened it at the Cleveland Cinematheque. This was also one of the, it was one of the first films I screened publicly that people were really excited about. I mean, because a lot of the stuff I did, people were like, okay, that's weird or whatever. But this was a film people were cheering about it. And I guess there were a lot of people that sort of felt the same way. I don't know. But yeah, that film was, it was enlightening because it was just a magic that went into that. And that was something that I was going to grow with. I just liked the idea of taking the bare essentials, just once again, basic tools and basic materials and just doing something that's magical that also has something to say. Because a lot of experimental films tend to be really, really cryptic or psychologically out there. And they're sort of, they're more like art pieces that people have to look and try and figure out. I wanted this to be something that could be entertaining as well as enlightening, is also fun to watch, you know, and a very innocence to it. Because that was the other thing too. I mean, I wanted the film to have a sort of a childlike element to it, which is a lot of the films that I make do that anyway. A lot of it is just reflective of that. And that's what this film is to me. I mean, literally when I made that, it was pretty much, you know, when you're a little kid, you're making a little pie, you're putting it in the oven, you're watching as it grows. Right. That's what this was like, because every edit that I made, which was cut and spliced, there was no digital with this. This was all hands-on. I would make the edit, paint on the film, hold it up to the light. I would run it through the projector, project it, and stand there and watch it just like the kid looking in the oven.
Like old school.
Yeah, it was, yeah. And that's how that film was made. And that literally, for that whole period, it was literally that. Sit down, cut, paint on, hold it up, splice it, run it through, look at it. Same thing. That's how it was, you know. And there was that magic to it and that sense of innocence. And so it was just, that was really enlightening. Because I made a few films similar to that before that, but this was the one that actually was even more unique because we had the soundtrack that actually merged everything together. The soundtrack reinforced it, and his score just took it to the next level. So yeah, that, I'm very proud of that film.
Yeah, you should be. So you've taught at Cleveland State University.
Yeah.
You've taught at Cleveland Institute of Art.
Yep.
And currently you're teaching at New Bridge Center.
Yeah. So
talk about that a little bit, your teaching. Are these high school students or?
Well, the teaching thing is interesting because the teaching unofficially was kind of accidental. When I first started teaching unofficially, I was actually like sort of more like a visiting artist. Some friends of mine, and this is just before I was making, just when I was making the Malcolm X film, some friends of mine were doing what they call the Neighborhood Film Project. My friend Kate Brissell, Carol Tozzano, and I forgot the rest of the young ladies' names, but they wanted to do a workshop where they traveled around the different neighborhoods, community centers, churches, homeless shelters, Planned Parenthood, places like that. And we would do these little film workshops. And it was meant to be more like a meet and greet, icebreaker, what do you call it? I guess you could say we were basically reaching out into the neighborhoods. We wanted people to sort of to get something therapeutic almost with the process of filmmaking traditionally. And I was showing them how to do animation, painting on clear leader film, just like I did with the Malcolm X film. And unofficially, that got me back into the painting on the film stuff because I was doing it long before, but showing people how to do it was kind of fun. So that sort of inspired me. So giving back to the community, I thought was a good thing. And this was back in like 1990-91. Years later though, another filmmaker friend of mine, I'm just name dropping left and right here. There's a lot of filmmakers in Cleveland. Another filmmaker friend of mine who I worked with on his first feature, I was the cinematographer, and that was my first film that I did the cinematography for. He got a job teaching at the Institute of Art, I believe. And it was a film class he was teaching. And he wanted someone, he was teaching mainly directing and working with actors for the camera. But he really wasn't a tech person. And he thought, hey, what if I bring another guy to teach the technical side of it? So he approached me, said, hey, could you teach how to shoot, how to light, how to do sound and all that stuff? I said, yeah, I could do that. And I was thinking this would be a one-time thing, whatever. I needed the money. And this was through the Institute of Art, through their extended studies program or continuing education. And so I did that. And it wound up being a big success. And people asked, hey, can you guys do that again? And everybody was lining up to enroll. And then Dave at one point said, well, Rob, I want to go and do something else. You can handle this. And all of a sudden, the whole thing was left in my lap. And so I was there for literally like 5 years teaching, which was unexpected because it was meant to be just a one-time thing. So that led to me also doing workshops at other schools. And all of a sudden, I was asked to teach at Cleveland. I can't remember if it was either Cleveland State or Tri-C. It was all of a sudden, it was CIA, Tri-C, Cleveland State, Lake Erie College.
Wow.
And a few other schools. I did traveling workshops with at the time they were Progressive Arts Alliance. I did stuff with them. So I was mainly working with adults, and then I wound up working with younger people, middle school kids, high school kids, and all that. That went on for a while, and it was a great thing. The problem was I was doing more teaching and less filmmaking. That was the only issue.
Right.
And I really wanted to make stuff and not really, you know. But out of that time frame, and this is like since 1998, a lot of these people, young people, have just taken off. Some of them are in the industry. Some of them are working in L.A., New York, Chicago. Some of them have done big budget movies now.
Wow.
And some of them have literally just evolved in their careers. And that makes me feel great to know that. I mean, I was like, wow, that's one of my kids. At the same time, when I got the job at Newbridge, they were the newest thing because, I would say, Bill Strickland started the NCAT program up in Pittsburgh, and he wanted to expand it. And Cleveland was one of the guinea pigs to expand it to. And they were looking for people to come in and teach high school kids.
High school kids, okay.
And Donald Black was the first, one of the first photographers they approached, and they approached me. And I told them, well, I'm trying to get out of teaching. And, you know, so, but when I went and visited the facilities, and I saw what was available, and I was like, wow, this is nice. So sure enough, I was, and I've been with them ever since. So that was back in 2010, October of 2010. So,
these are high school students?
High school students. And we've done a few things with adult students too. The school has an adult program for healthcare.
Gotcha.
And now it's more of a healthcare school. We have nursing, phlebotomy, and all that. And then the arts program, which is a youth program, that's what I'm part of. And I was teaching I teach pretty much photography, or at least I was for most of the time. And then we dabbled in filmmaking a little bit too. Now, this is gonna segue into where you're going next, I can tell. because being there ate up most of my time, even though it was great. And I was doing a lot of photography. And yeah, the photography was something that I got into mainly to improve my knowledge of cinematography, because it's about the light, it's about the color, it's about the composition. And granted, I can make a bunch of films, but which gets a little expensive. So shooting stills would also allow me to explore that, as well as traditional drawing and everything. So all that ties into in terms of how I come up with an idea or how I evolve a concept, whatever, visually through the lens, whatever. And so when I was teaching at Newbridge, they asked me, could I teach filmmaking as well? I said, yeah, sure, I can do that. But I told them, it's just the problem is now, because the new generation of kids are so sucked into the whole digital thing with their phones and everything and all that, and whole YouTube and TikTok and all stuff. So trying to get them to focus on the bare essentials of cinema is really tough. And that was the problem. However, I was in the midst of another project, which kicked off a few months after I started at Newbridge, which would have been my first feature. And that film would be Paper Shadows. And so I was working on that on my free time. And then I came up with an idea of maybe utilizing that as a teaching curriculum for filmmaking with these kids. So for a semester, I said, hey, can I have my students work on a real movie? And this way they can be trained, they can learn the process, it'll get them to understand the fundamentals of communication, the fundamentals of certain academics, including math and English and science and all. So they love the idea. So for like a semester and a half, two semesters, I actually worked on the film with the kids. And so a third of that film was shot with high school kids. And this wasn't with video cameras or phones. I think we were working an actual 35 millimeter film that we had donated and rented to us. So we were using Aeroflex 35 millimeter movie cameras.
This a feature or?
Paper Shadows, yeah, that was the feature.
Okay.
Yeah, that was, Paper Shadows was technically my first feature that I directed.
Okay.
Yeah. Once again, this was going into the vein of you're going into something that you're really not prepared for, but you know, you gotta take the big plunge, you know, going.
Right,
that's what this was. So, but at the same time, trying to educate people into doing this as well, in terms of doing this sort of expressionist black and white film on celluloid, that was a task and a half. And that brought a lot of things home in terms of understanding where we are as a city and as a community. Because one, I wanted to prove that anybody and everybody can do this, regardless where they come from. Some of the kids got turned off and bored by it. Some of them really got excited and they were inspired. And some of them just embraced it. And the same thing with the adults too. There were a lot of adults that are like, what are you doing? Why are you? My lead actor, especially Mr. James Ewing, good friend of mine. You should have him on your show one day. he was a theater guy. He was old school Caramu. He was with them. And he thought he knew what I was doing, but he realized, what are you doing this for? Why are we doing that? What's that camera? What am I saying that for? And you know, once again, there are a lot of people here that aren't really in tune with old school pseudo nonlinear storytelling. And so for a lot of people, this was kind of an eye opener. And the end result of that film wound up kind of mixed, because a lot of people, first off, a lot of people don't like black and white cinema, right, which I'm still baffled by. But they also didn't understand, why would you do a film that's more, once again, like the Malcolm X film or like the other films I made, something that's more commentary. Because this film was basically an essay about living in the Midwest and coming from nothing, but you're trying to compete with all these things that you have no control over, because it's all about where you come from and who you know and everything. And that's what the film's basically about, but it's very metaphoric in its delivery and everything. So, and I wanted to make something that I knew that I couldn't make on a more Hollywood level, you know.
Well, hey, yeah, let's take a look at a clip from Paper Shadows by Robert Banks.
Black, yellow, brown, red, and white. Fingers grab a pen or punch a pad to write. Man, woman, child, and in between. Copy down to see what they see. Where their voices carry on with fiction or speak personal truths. To say we are the same as contradiction. So we can see ways. So you can see that you and I are me. Yeah, right, you and what army? Mayor's contract, cancer's district, colorblind beneath. Opening consciences like traffic light. Power of the pen. So much strong, delivering me. Pam, where are you going?
I gotta leave. I gotta go somewhere else where I can do more things for myself and what I want to do.
Did you leave?
No, I'm leaving my family too. Yeah, but I'll be back to visit, and I'll come back and visit you guys.
I see it as it is, but the majority of people here don't. Everyone just kind of goes to work every day and does their thing and come home and support their family and do the same thing the next day. There's just so much that's there. And it's just, people just don't realize what an impact it is. It's an everyday thing. People just do what they have to do and that's it. Nobody goes further
and beyond. Irving Johnson, spy, janitor, espionage, pigeons. Irving Johnson. Irving Johnson, spy, sunglasses, trench coat. Irving Johnson.
Great work. Quick question.
It's out there.
So what essentials do you teach your students about filmmaking? Something that they must incorporate in their work.
It's funny you mention that, because when I teach the kids, I teach these young people the way I wanted to be taught when I was their age. And so I try to leave out all the technical stuff. And I try to get them to understand, you got to first get up out of bed, even though you may be tired or groggy, whatever. Look in the mirror, take a deep breath, and just be thankful you have all these senses. You know, you have your brain, which you want to try, and that's like gold right there. Your heart and all the blood going through you. And then you're able to breathe, you're able to taste, you're able to touch. You know, you got to embrace and celebrate that, because that's part of who you are. And more than anything else, your sight. Because that triggers all that stimuli that goes within you and all that. And so to me, that's, if you're a visual artist or any kind of artist, you know, that's key. You have to really embrace that, and you have to treat that, and yet it's a blessing from God. Every day you have that, you make the most of it, because every so often you have to take time to think about, you know, without that, what do you have, you know? So, and the people that don't have that, they can still make the most of a lot, and they're still happy and blessed. So you really got to cherish that. I try to get all my students to be aware of, you have these gifts within you. Don't abuse them, don't neglect them. Then think about something that really triggers something in your mind, and how would you want to present that? Because some people want to make art for release. I mean, I'm that way. You just want to express something and release this tension or whatever, you make something. And then some people would like to make something that they want to express and get out there. And so I tell them, think about something that makes you happy or makes you sad, or you want people to feel, or something that you're feeling. And then think about how you can present that in a way that's going to really reach out and strike a nerve with the audience and everything. You got to think about what you're saying in terms of how you're saying it and how it's going to reach out and how people are going to react to it and whether it's going to, what emotional impact it's going to give them. Those are the key elements right there. Then you think about what's the best way of getting it captured and then presenting it. And then once you decide upon that and the look and all those elements of the look, the color, you know, the shapes, you know, all that stuff, it's who you are. Every person has their own sense of communicating, like when we talk and everything. And it's the same thing when you capture something, whether it's a painting or whether it's, you know, a sculpture, or whether it's a dance move or whether it's a music composition, the same thing. So I just try to get them, more than anything, those are the bare essentials. Those are the key elements that's going to make them stand out from the other people that they're competing against. And not that it's a competition, because it shouldn't be, but a lot of people want to be able to express themselves. The problem with being a filmmaker, though, is the average person or the average audience member strictly want to be entertained. And so if there's a way you can pull this off as well as keeping the audience engaged and making them laugh, cry, get nervous or angry, whatever, that's even better. Even if they hate what you did, that's good, because you struck a nerve. So this is what's important. The only thing outside of all that that's important, more than anything else, I guess, is if it has longevity, if it can hold up for 100 years or 200 years. You said something and it's gonna resonate for other generations to embrace and learn from. That, to me, it's the ultimate success right there. But it's not about making a lot of money overnight. A lot of people think about this as being a way of getting rich and famous and whatnot, and that's cool, but to me, the main benefit is if you get the audience that you need, that will grow. I mean, you're planting a seed and you're gonna watch it grow, and that's part of the magic, and you have to really embrace and celebrate that. It's hard to teach that nowadays because everything is so fast and everything is so spontaneous, and now we're in this whole metaverse nonsense, and everything is just anything and everything, and everybody, anything can get, it's just, a lot of stuff's gonna just fall off on the wayside, and it's just gonna come back in another form, or in another form of media, or another form of marketing. And social media has allowed many people to do these things, but the problem is so many people are getting lost. I see stuff on Instagram and on TikTok and stuff that's really cool, really informative, really enlightening, but yet nobody's really viewing it. It may get a few views or a few likes. And then I see some of the most stupidest, ignorant stuff being put out there, and it's getting hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of likes or views. And it's just, you know, it's all subjective. But at the same time, young people get affected by that because they want that sense of notoriety. But you just got to explain to them how, or try to explain to them that it doesn't really matter. Time is the key element that's going to really decide whether this has any value or not. And it's just those bare essentials. That's what you really got to wake up every morning and be thankful and have the motivation to do it, regardless what it is you're doing it with, you know. So, yeah.
You enjoy doing workshops, conducting workshops and people. I saw a clip that I want to share with my audience. I think it was Creative Mornings.
Yes.
You doing a segment of Creative Mornings.
Yeah.
let's take a look at Robert in his element.
Moments. That's something that I pretty much eat, drink, sleep 24/7. Living a moment, conceptualizing a moment, creating the moment, recreating the moment, sharing the moment. Those pieces of celluloid you have, those are all moments. Those are many, many moments. As a visual artist in a time-based medium like cinema, you're always racking your brain to try and think of an idea that might be worthy of presenting to a mass audience. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that. Well, actually, hey, that's even better. Oh, cool, thanks. Much better. All right. The last Picacha I did way back when, I did a similar thing. I just took the mic off like this.
Oh, cool. All right. Now I'm flexible because I can't stand still. A lot of what I do in terms of making art, and I have to stress making art, photography and filmmaking, those are the mediums that I work with. I do traditional drawing as well. I paint a little bit, not that well, but I still paint. But I'm more or less a traditionalist in terms of creating stuff. And since the topic and the theme is moments, I guess we can sort of dwell upon that in terms of the motivations of what I do and why I do things for moments and everything, because I am a filmmaker, but I'm not your traditional filmmaker. Living and working in the city of Cleveland all these years has been a phenomenal boost in me doing things and challenging myself and all that, whereas I could have gone to New York or LA, which people have criticized me for not doing that sooner, but I have a mom here. She's 91 years old, and ever since my dad passed away, which will be 30 years this coming October, I promised I wouldn't leave her by herself, which is why I got out of the military. And I figured, well, here's a chance for me to see if I can make something happen in a city like Cleveland, which is definitely a great place for hands-on labor. We have all the greatest in, you know, construction, salt, steel mills. We're all about that. We're a blue-collar city, and we're all about getting our hands dirty. I mean, outside my studio, which is why I didn't get much sleep this morning or this entire week, they're tearing up something in the side street on 19th Street, and there's a big pile driver there, and there's cones, and these construction workers show up there every morning. They've been showing up there since this past Friday every morning, making noises, yelling, swearing, spitting, laughing. You know, I hear the machines going, and I'm kicking myself because it would have made great audio, especially Foley audio, especially machines going and all that. But I'm thinking, man, it doesn't get any better than this. This is who we are. This is what we are. And in that sense, that goes back to the whole idea of why I do things the way I do, because I'm all about hands-on. I'm all about physically making things. And any good artist here, whether they do jewelry or enameling or ceramics or paper making, whatever, traditional printmaking, it's all about working with your hands. When I make my films, I like using my hands.
So how did that come about?
Tom over there at Creative Mornings approached me. This was years ago, because he's seen some of my films and he knew about he knew about what was evolving from Paper Shadows, and they wanted to know if I can come in and sort of express that, because for what I put into Paper Shadows, the average filmmaker in Cleveland would never have touched that. So he just felt that, well, you went on this big odyssey, because that film took me 3.5 years to make, and it was an odyssey and a half for me, and he was asking me, could I come and talk about that? I'm just thinking, well, it's kind of a boring thing to talk about, but that's what I did. I mean, it's funny you mentioned Element. I'm not much of a talker, as you can see. I'm all groggy here, but when I'm more of my element when I'm actually working with people making stuff, even then I'm sort of like, because I'm a people person, but I'm not a people person, because when it comes to me being creative, I'm in my element, like when I'm by myself. But when I try to explain this to like 40, 50 people in a room, or when I'm doing a screening and there's a Q&A, it's kind of awkward. So Creative Morning was basically like just me giving a big speech about what I do, but also kind of a Q&A. But it was weird because I didn't really have much to show. I showed, I think, X the Baby Sim, I showed that. And I had still images from Paper Shadows. But a lot of people were intrigued by, they were intrigued at the fact that I can pull off something like that, because people in Cleveland, when they hear that, oh, you're making a film, or is it a documentary, or is it this? And I'll say, well, no, like I mentioned earlier, it's a black and white expressionist film about creative angst in a blue-collar Rust Belt city from the perspective of an elderly black man and a young white art student. And they sort of come together, which still doesn't have much of a plot, because the film has no plot or anything. And when you try to explain that, it's just people were intrigued at that. People were like, you really did this? Because at that point, that film was just a rumor. Everybody thought it was just this weird rumor up until I was doing my Kickstarter, because I had to raise money for it. When the Kickstarter was happening, then all of a sudden people realized, wow, he's really doing something crazy like this. And so that's what that was about. I mean, I've done many talks like that where people are just, they're just baffled, because I guess for some reason, guys like me are like considered these weird, you know, I'm like sort of like an incel. I'm like sort of keep to myself. I'm in my basement doing, and that's basically what it was when I made those earlier films and with Paper Shadows. I mean, I'm literally in this dark room by myself, hunched over, and just doing all this weird stuff and getting these sounds. And And if you, a friend of mine years ago said, I'm like a mad scientist in his lab, you know. Like,
I can see that.
Yeah, you know, like in my mom's basement, you know, or in the attic, which is what, you know, just I'm doing these weird things. And of course, when you're surrounded by all this gear and you're recording these sounds, or you're in a bathtub miking the water and you're scraping the bottom of the tub to get these sounds and everything, you know. But the funny thing is, if you're in an industry where they do this professionally, nobody laughs at that. They're like, yeah, you know, industrial light magic or Skywalker sound or places like that. But but when you do this at home, people think this guy's got a few screws loose. And that's what it is. I mean, and going back to what you asked before, I wish people that want to be filmmakers would take time to know that whether you're doing a little film or a big film, you're going to get your hands dirty. You're going to get on your knees and crawl around and do the craziest stuff. But it may look weird when it's just one guy in a little room in a basement, or some guy in a big $2 million soundstage with all this high tech stuff. It's the same thing, you know. And there's been many filmmakers that started from one extreme to the other, you know. I mean, it's no big deal. And so when I do talks like that, that's what I try to express. It's just people here think that you are a freak and a weirdo, but everybody that's creative in the industry is a freak and a weirdo. I'm not saying you guys are, but you know, it's just, look at the films you made, you know. I mean, there's no glamour to this at all. And I just have no problem speaking out about that. There's this myth that there's glamour and all this. No, it's making films is a thankless job. And when I do those talks like that, I just wanted people, because they normally have people that come in that are like, you know, entrepreneurial type, you know, business. Right. But here I am, this oddball dude talking about these weird films that I'm making, and had no shame in it. And I told my students, you know, if you have any fear of being embarrassed or being, you know, looking weird, you're in the wrong business, because the filmmakers that I admire, they have no problem doing that. I mean, some of the best films ever made were made by oddball men and women, you know. You can call them, people use the term incel as a negative thing. I think, granted, these are people that may have poor social skills. That doesn't mean that they're a bunch of worthless individuals. They have a lot of talent, you know, they have a lot of skill, and they're not all psychotic. And believe me, there are a lot of filmmakers out there, if they had their way, they would be psychotic, because this is a release for them, you know. So some of my favorite directors were like that, actually. So yeah.
So what's next for Robert Banks?
Well, I don't know if I can talk about it much. It's pending still. There's a project that's in development that, if it happens, it'll be my first commercial narrative film. Okay. I have to say, because it's... Because I here's the thing. I like mainstream movies. I do. People think that, oh, you're a film snob. You like artsy, weird stuff. It's like, no. I like commercial movies if they're entertaining, if they're well-made, well-written, well-directed. And there's been many films in the last 90 years that I've seen that are mainstream Hollywood that are brilliant, that I love, and I still
name
watch to this day. Apocalypse Now, Clockwork Orange, 2001 A Space Odyssey, Mad Max, okay. Sweetback's Badass Song. Well, that's more of an out there film.
Okay.
But no, there's a ton of movies. You know, West Side Story. I mean,
right.
It's just, you know. So, but there are people out here that feel that, oh, you can only do the artsy stuff because that's easy. It's like, no, the artsy stuff's the hardest stuff. All those films that I've made, if people look them up, more than half of those films were intense struggles and were almost broke me. And Paper Shadows almost mentally broke me, which I knew I was getting myself into. But it's not, those films are way harder than a narrative. Now, the narrative stuff, the conventional stuff, is easy, especially if you have a full staff and a production team and a real budget. It's easy, you know. This film, it's getting off to a rough start, the one we're in development with right now, because we're still trying to finalize a few things. But it's kind of easy working on this because I have other people doing some of the hard work, making the phone calls, doing the emails. And we'll know by the end of next month if it's going to fly. And it looks like it might be flying. But you'll be hearing about that. And I'm doing this mainly for... I want the experience of doing a more commercial type stuff anyway, but I also want to work towards maybe getting a certification of doing stuff like this on the side. You know, maybe not features like this, but maybe commercials or whatnot, because I can do that stuff too. I've done many commercials, I've done many music videos, I've done loads of documentaries. But no, I would like to do more commercial stuff. So this project coming up, if it flies, and if it does take off, you'll know about it. Maybe we can do this again. We'll talk about
it.
Yeah. Because if it happens, it'll probably be shot in Cleveland. Actually, I got to fly out to LA, actually, believe it or not, because we're doing a casting call out there. And
that's great. That's
and
incredible.
So we'll see how it goes. But that's, you know, that's the next thing in the works. Aside from that, though, I guess I should point out, we didn't talk about this, the Dexter Davis collaborations. Dexter Davis, who I mentioned, is a friend of mine. from CIA at the Institute of Art. He was in the Front International last year, or the Front Biennial. You know, the Front.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I was commissioned by the MoCA, the Museum of Contemporary Art, to do a series of short films on Dexter. And since a lot of this evolved out of our friendship since the 80s, and then we did doing the film stuff, because he was one of the first elements of my filmmaking that actually broke through, it would only seem fitting that, you know, since he's now about to become huge, he's already huge, but he's about to be bigger, to do a film series of films on him. So I did 7 films on him. Some of the films played at the Cinematheque this past summer of last year. We had an art opening, and 2 of the films are yet to be screened, and they're going to be released hopefully next year. There's a good chance they might even premiere at the Cleveland Film Festival. We'll see. We don't know for sure yet. We'll find out.
Okay.
But hopefully they will. But either way, these films will be out next year. And once again, these were all films shot on film, 16 millimeter and 35 millimeter. And it was really interesting because me and Dexter, we were close friends, and we were still close friends, but we sort of rekindled our friendship. Because for a while, we were like doing 2 different things. He had a lot of family stuff. I had a lot of family stuff and art stuff. He's a guard at the art museum, and I'm teaching. So we, for a while, we weren't really connecting. And so we finally got reconnected. And he had a tragic incident because he was shot. He was injured because he was shot in a road rage incident, which was really insane. And so these things sort of brought us back together. It's funny because he was shot and I actually got robbed and assaulted too. So that's a whole story right there.
Yeah.
But it's just all these things sort of, you know, reconnected us and brought us back together. And so that's the newest thing in terms of new work that's coming out. And this will be my first feature documentary since the one I did back in the mid 90s.
Okay.
And so, but that'll be, you'll have that to look forward to. And like I said, this other film, which you'll hear about it if it happens, which it will, I think.
Yeah.
Well, and then from there, we'll see what flies, because I know for a fact I want to keep doing this, but at the same time, I'm not as young as I used to be. And that's the one thing I'm learning now, that the older you get, the harder it is to run around, rig up stuff, move things, set the camera, hold the camera. It's getting harder. I'm just thinking, wow, I'm not as, you know, I'm still thinking I'm like 19 years old. And yet it's like, wow, it's like I'm getting up there. So I think more than ever, maybe, yeah, I should have a good crew that could do some of the stuff for me, but I can still give direction.
You will.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, because I still enjoy the tech stuff. I still like moving stuff, you know.
Well, be sure to keep me posted.
No, I will. Oh, definitely.
Thank you so much for being on the show.
Oh, thank you guys. Thank you.
So that's it, Cleveland. We're out. But remember, a true artist is not only inspired, but inspires others. I'm Cornell Hubert Calhoun III for TV20 and Creative Focus. Until the next time becomes our time, be well, be safe.